everybody to Cream episode number 23. Shout out to Michael Jordan, MJ himself, or number 23, Fernando Tatis, who is now pissed off that he is not going to the next round of the Major League Baseball playoffs because he got caught with steroids. Welcome everybody to the Cream podcast.
Jason, now we're going to talk about public enemy number one, which, believe it or not, is not just interest rates, but probably is the Fed, because they keep raising interest rates and it's freaking out economists. It's freaking out CEOs and banks and Wall Street. And it's definitely freaking out the normal consumer. So what is going on with interest rates and the Fed?
So great question, Norm. So what we're seeing right now is the U.S., United States, actually the whole world, is trying to battle inflation. We printed a whole lot of money, which has caused inflation. And then we also have supply chain issues. Right now, we're also going to have food issues right now with a Ukraine war and fertilizer. But United States is having its fastest rate hike it has ever has had. And right now, the U.S. stock market is in shock right now as we have raised rates faster than we ever have in history. Faster than 88, faster than 94, faster than 99, faster than 04, and faster than 2015. And a lot of experts are thinking we're going to raise rates one more time in November and then another time in the beginning of the year, and it will go from there as far as raising rates. And the raise,
and they think, also, not to interject, but they think they're going to be, based on these latest job numbers, but also inflation data that was way higher than they expected. They think they're actually going to bump them up, maybe even another 75 basis points, you know, 0.75%, both November and December, huh? Like big, two more big interest rate hikes.
Too much big interest rate hikes. And if they do that, we could see interest rates before the end of the year at 4% from being at a 0% interest rate in the last year at this time, which is bananas to hear after we went through 12 years of low interest rates. And now we're having a huge interest rates hike that the first we have seen in my generation of being an adult.
A lot of people are saying the Fed is overreacting or overcorrecting and basically plunging us into recession when it doesn't have to, and it should have started earlier with these interest rate hikes, of course. But what are your thoughts about how aggressively and quickly the Fed is raising rates, and is that wise, or what would your plan be if you were Fed chairman?
I think they did make a huge mistake with not raising interest rates when it should have last year, when we first kept using the famous word transitory. The interest rate is going to be, and now we found out they were going to be permanent. They should have raised the rates at that time. One thing is, you don't want you don't want inflation to get out of hand. So I understand you don't want it to not do enough work, and you might go over of the bounds of how much you raise interest rates. But it's easier to fight a recession than it is to fight inflation. We see that in Venezuela. We see that in Zimbabwe. We saw that after World War One in Germany. So you don't want inflation to get out of hand. So you got to do the right measures. And I know everybody wants cheap money, but there's a reason why for it. I think we all forget how bad life can be if inflation gets out of hand.
What do you see happening in 2023?
We still haven't seen a couple of things. One is Bank of America says we're going to start seeing unemployment of about 175,000 people lose their jobs. We simply do not see those lost jobs yet. Actually, we have a shortfall of a number of people who are working in this country.
There's still about two available jobs to every available adult person working or looking to fill it.
Correct. Which is absolutely crazy. And because I've been wondering, you know, before, even last year, I was wondering where all these people are going to go back to work after the unemployment benefits ran off from COVID. And yet those people still have not came back to work. So the question is, where are those people? And where are those people? Also, we see that home prices have been going up. Interest rates for homes, I apologize, have been drastically going up. And we know it's more to service debt even for businesses. And the Fed said they want to slow down the economy, but yet we haven't seen any bankruptcies like you would normally see in recession for its corporate bankruptcies. So next year is going to, the question is, next year, are we going to finally see bankruptcies? And are we going to see the layoffs that Bank of America was talking about? Or are we going to fall into this pit called stagflation?
And that's the real, from what you've educated me, that's the real, elephant in the room that we need to be careful of and we want to avoid, because that's way worse than any recession. Recession is usually, pretty mild and pretty short term, and then things bounce back pretty robustly. But stagflation is the real enemy, huh?
It is, because once you hit stagflation, it's hard to get out of it, because you need to stimulate the economy. In order to stimulate the economy, you need to cut interest rates. But if you have inflation, you want to take the money, you want to slow down the economy and take money out of the system. So you need to raise interest rates and tie it up the money flows and take money out of the system. So it's a conflict of interest to fix either one. And that's the problem with stagflation, is you don't know how to get out of it, because the one way to fix one side of it is the opposite of what you need to do for the other, which is the question we don't know how to solve if we ever get into that.
Wow, crazy. Yeah, well, definitely we know what course the Fed is on. They've doubled, tripled down. And like you said, the language has gone from this is transitory to soft landing to a gentle recession to no, we're all fucked. We're, they're just like throwing up their hands, especially when you talk about mortgage rates in the housing market. They're like, no, we're pushing this thing off the cliff. So it, home prices go down 10% or something, and we reset it all. And so they pretty much have just thrown up their hands and conceded to a major economic downturn. All right, Jason, now we just talked a lot about the U.S. economy and interest rate hikes and the Fed. And now we're going to talk about why all of that is happening, which is inflation. And you sent me this past week some really startling stats and data on U.S. inflation over the past year and the latest inflation numbers. So why don't you share that with us?
Yeah, so I recently got the stats of inflation on certain items that we see. And a couple of the big ones I see is, one is health insurance, which is up 28.2. So it's up over a quarter of what we used to just a year ago pay for. Airline tickets are up 42.9%. So that means last year, if you bought an airline ticket, it was $100. Now it's $140 for that airline ticket.
So airline tickets, man, I feel that pain. I know everyone feels their own pain, whether it's at the grocery store or whatever. But, I wanted to stop and let you know airline tickets are really hurting people.
Wow. Plus, you also fly first class, Norm. You need the extra leg room. You're so
man,
tall.
They got me in the luggage compartment in one of those dog carriers.
But so it's crazy. Also, it's like you see eggs are up 30% for eggs this year. Yeah. Dairy products up almost 16%. Fat and oil up 21%. Baby food is up almost 12%. And cereals up 16%. So for basic essential stuff, you see inflation rising. And other things that might not be, are more luxuries, that's where we see the prices slowing down, such as movie and theater concerts have slowed down. Hotels are starting to slow down. So might be because people are not traveling as much. So we're going through this inflationary period, which I'm not sure if interest rates are going to be able to slow down inflation as much as they would like.
And it seems like there's a big lag, right? Like the Fed could keep hiking these rates like crazy, but that's such an indirect determiner of inflation for the average person, for these household goods, for the food store, for these services, for your utility bill. So it's almost like a lot of wasted effort and a big time lag. So they're probably going to, if they did nothing now, we'd probably see inflation start coming down, reflected in the numbers in 3 months or 6 months or something, right? But they're probably going to overshoot it and really do some damage to the economy. But of course, inflation is what gets people angry. It's what gets politicians voted out of office, right? So they have to, Biden could do everything right. But if there's high inflation, then everyone could just hammer him when it's election time.
And I think as a society, we're getting to the point where we think that government is supposed to solve everything. And I don't actually think that's the case. So, for instance, even though they're raising interest rates, how can they actually control the price of eggs? If there's lack of chicken, if they can't get fertilizer, if you can't get enough food for the eggs, that has nothing to do with interest rates or costing more to service the debt of interest rates.
If the feed for the chickens is made from wheat that and grain that's grown in the Ukraine, right? I mean, what? How does the Fed going to impact that, right?
Right. So I think they can only do so much. And I think we're at, as a society, we have to stop thinking that the feds are not the feds, just the government period can solve everything. And the case is they cannot. And, you know, certain things you knew was going to cost. We during COVID, we paying for so much for people to get free COVID shots. That stuff wasn't for free. You know, eventually going to come down to your premiums, so was going to go up from it. So we can't just think that they're going to just be there for us the whole time. We have to be a little bit smarter to think that the government can't solve everything for us. We won't have to go through some suffering.
Jason, so we just talked a lot about inflation, and that ties in with what's happening with the stock market right now. One thing you said when we were talking about inflation is people expect the government to solve all our problems and to fix everything. And I also see that a lot of folks now are a little too spoiled after, for lack of a better word, after 12 years or 10 years of hot economic growth. And they think that things are always going to be rosy. They think their 401k, their stock portfolio, everything is always going to be going up, 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 up. But, you know, there's one great quote, I forget who said it, but it's like the average person forgets the past economic cycle about as often as the past economic cycle, right? And we forgot those days that these downturns are normal and even needed. So what are you seeing now with the stock market, and what are some words of wisdom for folks to stick in there?
Yeah, stock market, you see a lot of volatility right now. You see a downright downturns in the market. The good thing about downturns in the market is, one, it allows us to get things at a more affordable price. Also, it should eliminate or does eliminate companies that have bad financials or fundamentals. And as an investor, if you have a long time horizon, you could wave the storm. If you have 10, 15, 20, 25 years towards retirement, you could go through the storm and just be fine because you know it's going to bounce back. But it tells you at this point is to look for strong companies that have great cash flows, who make a profit, not just these fly-by-night companies that have no intrinsic value, that have negative cash flow and don't have a plan for cash flow, who just been leveraging tons of debt. And so I think it just gets back to the fundamentals. And I think it's like Vince Lombardi, who was a great Packers head coach. Every time he took a loss, the next practice, they only worked back on the fundamentals on how to block and how to tackle. And I think downturns just remind us to go back to the fundamentals of what we should be looking for. Good, strong companies that have good financials, have good management, and who are doing really good things.
Mm. Yeah, and we definitely saw that, you know, weeding out of bad companies, bad ideas, bad CEOs, bad financials, with the tech bubble too. You know, when that there was so many venture capitalists just throwing money at tech. You know, when it's a hot sector, that it just rises based not on merit but based on speculation, really. And so now that goes away and we look at strong fundamentals. The other thing that I've read a lot about is that the stock market really reflects the future. And so they're really now, with all this turbulence and volatility and stocks just crashing, they're really pricing in the fear and danger of next year, of a recession, of future, you know, inflation and interest rate hikes and unemployment. Not based on what's today, but what's in the future and the worst case scenario, huh?
You're right. Absolutely. So they are looking at the future, saying worst case scenario, where do we see everything headed? Which is what the stocks is. I'm investing into this company because I think in the future they will do well. I'm not going to invest in it because I think they're going to do bad in the future. That's what you're doing when you're investing in stocks or bonds in the company. But I think we got, especially during COVID, I think we got away from that with so many companies and ideas like Forex. I know when people start investing in Forex and they didn't know what they were doing in the crypto market. I'm not saying cryptocurrency is bad, but people, if you ask them what makes the value go up, they couldn't tell you. It's just that more people just jumping into it.
That their neighbor bought it. Yeah, and their coworker bought it. That's what makes the value go up.
Right. Know? And everybody, and at that point, everybody's a guru. And when everybody's a guru, that's when you should watch out, because that's when they, when you know those sectors is going to just drop.
Do you remember the movie Training Day?
I love the movie Training Day.
That's an amazing movie, right? I just watched that again, and that's got to be, you know, what, 15 years old now or longer? I don't even know, but that's a great movie. And you have this rookie green cop, you know, who's on the deep narcotics, like the heavy
21 years old,
squad.
By the way, 21 years old.
That's crazy. And he was out of his mind on drugs at the time, but they asked him, like, you know, figure out the streets. And he said, smiles and cries, right? And you got to control your smiles and cries. And he said, if you figure that out, you figure out the streets. Well, the stock market might be like that, huh? It's fear and greed. It's getting too high and having to hit the brakes, even when everyone around you is making money and buying into the greed. And then it's controlling your cries when everything dips and everyone is freaking out and fear and, you know, permeates the market. That's when you control on the downside. That's when you control your cries and make sure that you're looking towards the next cycle. So, right.
And you're absolutely right about that. And while everybody's crying, people are looking for opportunities. There's going to be gaps where you can take full advantage of. And this is where people become wealthy. And the wealthiest usually get, people become wealthy using the downturns, not in the upswings, but using the downturns. When I went to Huntington Beach a couple weeks ago for one of my vendors, and I heard their head investment, the head of their investment portfolio, which they have about 90 billion or 900 billion, something crazy, but had a 9-0 with it. They were saying what they're looking for is the gaps and opportunities in the market that people don't see right now. While everybody else is crying, they're looking and they're grave dancing, which I love to hear. I like to say is they're grave dancing, looking for opportunities. And I think they're out there if you're looking, but if you feel like the world's coming to an end and the inflation is going to be here forever, then you're looking totally wrong at the situation.
So I love it. Yeah. So smiles and cries. So if Training Day was actually the Cream podcast, I guess that would make me Denzel, right? And you're the other dude, right? Do we got that right? Jason, now on the Cream podcast, we're going to talk about auto loan hell. Too many people are in auto loan hell. Tell us why.
The average monthly payment for a new car right now is above $700 a month. And 14% of consumers are paying over $1,000 for a new car. As we say, interest rates are also rising, and I'm actually seeing them in the new car space as well. So prices are going to continue to go up, which is bananas.
That's crazy. And when people say that they can't balance their budget, they don't have money to invest, they don't have money to buy a home and pay their mortgage payment for a new property or a rental property because the interest rates have gone up so much. Most of it is their asset, or what they think is an asset, sitting in the driveway. We know it's really a liability. And instead of putting money in the stock market, instead of saving, instead of paying off other debt, instead of buying a property, they're actually just wasting a bunch of money on their new car payment, whether it's a lease or, like you said, one out of seven people pay $1,000 a month for a new car. That's insane, huh?
It is. It's crazy. As I get these emails from this website, this guy, he does car reviews called Doug DeMiro. And he has a website called Cars and Bids. And it's crazy how many people who are buying brand new cars from a couple of years ago on a list like the new H2, the new Bronco, the new Rivian truck, and they're buying straight from a dealership and put it on this website, and they're selling it 30, 40, 50, 60% over RSVP, and people are willing to do that right now and don't care. It's bananas.
Yeah,
and I get the email all the time. Look at this Rivian cars truck bought for over $100,000 for a pickup truck. Just because it's electric, which is not smart. So,
yeah, that's out of control. And I don't know. I think people are buying automobiles and cars and leasing, and everything's got to be new and the nicest. I think it's really to their detriment. So, the economy has problems and corporations are getting, you know, are taking more CEOs and the wealthy are getting wealthier, but the average US consumer is also probably doing some things they shouldn't do. And so they're complicit if they don't have enough for retirement, if they don't actually have assets that are going to produce them, produce wealth or produce cash flow for them down the road. So just think of that $700, $1,000 a month. You could keep driving your still fine car that's 5 years old and just drive it till the wheels fall off and no one cares, or you could waste $1,000 a month.
And if you want a new car, right? We hear, all I was going to say, you walk in on, you know, dancing on, you're dancing on funerals or grave sites, dancing on grave sites of phrases. If I was people, I really want a new car. Maybe the idea is right now, maybe go on Craigslist, find somebody who's behind on the car note and take over the car note. That might be an idea for you if you have.
Oh, that's
to have
a great idea. That's a great idea. Huh?
And maybe take over their car note. They got it at a lower rate than you're probably going to get it now. They have the car you want. It might be a couple years older than what you expected, but hey, you might be able to get something off their hands, and it's a great deal for you.
Jason, now on the Cream podcast, we're going to talk about something that all of sports radio, YouTube, social media, sports fans, and the whole Bay Area is talking about: the Draymond Green punch heard and seen around the world. So what's your take on the Draymond punch?
I think it's just part of the game, man. The Draymond punch, you know, Michael Jordan punched Steve Kerr. It's just that this time it was on video, and just interesting how it came out on video. Jordan Poole, if you push somebody, know that you should get ready for them to push you back or get punched. So keep your guard up at all times, Jordan. Keep your guard up for all times. At the same time, Jordan Poole just got broken out from the Warriors, so he's about to be there for a long time. Draymond just took a pay, not going to get that bump that he wanted in an extension. He probably just gave a portion of it to Jordan Poole after that hit. But, hey, we're going to win another championship. This dynasty is going to continue. But, hey, Jordan Poole, I'm glad your jaw is okay.
Man, and, I mean, everything you said is true. You know, I'm sure – you go back to the 60s, 70s, 80s, there was dudes punch. I mean, look at NFL, you know, people are punching each other every single practice. Guys get heated. That being said, he threw a shot. He was trying to like knock him out, knock his mama out, knock his uncle out, knock a couple generations of his family out with that punch.
He didn't try. He knocked him out.
I guess he moved back a little. It probably, I mean, if he had walked into that, or if he hadn't moved back, he would have been probably broken jaw and, you know, out a few months. But I don't know, man, that there's punches and there's, you know, some deep anger issues, punches, because for your own teammate, that looked like, you know, something on the street or something. I don't know. So
they're saying they've been having issues back and forth for the last couple of years.
Draymond, I think he's the kind of guy that everyone hates. Of course, you know, I'm a Celtics fan. So I also think he's going to have a fall from grace. You know, his antics aren't going to, they're not going to put up with his antics forever. And Golden State Warriors now are thinking about, do we pay him a long-term near max contract like he wants? You know, he's not going to age well, his game, or can he go get overpaid and boss people around in the Detroit Pistons locker room or something like that?
Draymond's already preparing for life after basketball with his podcast, with his talking, with his podcast, and he'll be on TV. He's getting ready to take Charles Barkley's spot on TNT. He says, Charles getting old, I'm taking over. Plus, hey, if basketball, nobody wants to sign him, he can always do boxing because he has a great right
hand. My God. Yeah, that was crazy. So, Jason, now we're going to do the shout out of the podcast before we wrap this up. So who would you like to give some love to today?
Yeah, I want to give a love to Joshua Care. I went to their fundraiser for Joshua Care. Me and my wife did a couple weeks ago. Joshua Care is a great nonprofit that helps with children with autism. And right now they're pushing their initiative for Joshua Care, which is notifying and putting together a system. So if a kid has autism, he has a sensory issue, and someone calls 911 on the child, it will pop up to the police. The kid issues with his sensory and how to calm him down instead of them feeling like this guy is just crazy. They actually have services and know what to do when the 911 calls is called on to them, so there don't be a bad consequence from it. So I want to give out to Joshua Care for the great work and putting together that program and making sure that it expands in different cities and every city that's behind it and supporting the program, such as Fremont, San Jose Fire and Police, San Francisco, and Oakland.
That's amazing. That's really important. Like you said, you know, when the police show up, it could go from bad to extremely, you know, worse and catastrophic consequences when people don't understand if the child is autistic or on the spectrum or has these sensory issues. So what a wonderful service and charity and cause and solution. And I'm glad that you support them.
Everybody, thank you again for watching episode 23, episode of The GOAT. We really do appreciate it. We love you. If you really do like this episode, make sure you share with your friends, your network, your family about certain things you got from this. And make sure, let us know your thoughts as well. Love to hear back from you guys on how you feel about the Cream Podcast.